start, man. Being a DJ, right? Because I'll defend Jackmaster. I can't defend myself, you know, because I'm just a regular old guy with a 9-to-5, you know. You might shit in public sometimes and get in trouble for it. But, right? Being a DJ, right? Touring the world, doing as many dates as Jackmaster's doing, right? And I'm actually gonna get it up here because I wanna defend Jackmaster because I fucking love the guy. Right? So if you go back on Reddit Advisor here and we click on Jackmaster's name, it should link to obviously his RA page. So Jackmaster, being a touring DJ like Jackmaster, right? It's the summer, right? So his schedule's fucking off the chain. He's touring all over the world. It's really difficult because I'm hearing a lot of DJs now, especially I listen to this Giles Peterson podcast series called, I think, The Psychology of DJing or something like that, right? And he interviews Seth Troxler, Black Madonna, Cassie, I think Black Coffee or somebody else, a few other people, right? Check it out. He interviews Young Marco, right? I think he interviews Young Marco too. And he kind of dissects the psychology of a DJ. And for the most part, the more mature DJs, the older DJs have stopped doing drugs. Like Cassie's a good example, but no, she had a kid. And she had a kid during the time her career kind of started blowing up a little bit, so that kind of helped to change things. Black Madonna's the same sort of way as well, but I don't think Black Madonna even does any drugs at all. I'm not too sure. But for the most part, the mature ones I've been listening to, a lot of them, are now kind of like, I'm sure you've seen, I think Sven Vaz got a resort somewhere or kind of like a place out in Bali. But a lot of those guys are going to Bali now and doing that whole like unwinding thing. Where at the beginning of the season or the end of the season, they kind of do a thing where they kind of go away to Bali and do like no electronics, a complete kind of like isolation thing, loads of meditation, loads of yoga, loads of plant-based food to kind of reset the body a little bit, right? Because that touring schedule, unfortunately for a DJ, it requires you to live on the edge. You have to live on the edge. You have to be on a cusp of breaking point every single day. For the most part of it, especially if you're playing like, because I can't even, like, I get tired nowadays, right? Because I play a set on Fridays. Again, I'm DJing this Friday the 17th at Tappies for an actual tap. You can see the link below on the show description. I also pop it in my audio podcast link so you can check that out. Tap East in Westford, Stratford for a night called Tapped on the 17th of, August? From 5 to 11. So check that out too. So I get tired, right, playing from 7 to 11 or 7 to 12 sometimes, right? Or when I play at the Leighton Stone Star, which I'm going to be playing at August 26th on Bank Holiday Sunday. And I played there from, like, I don't know, let's say like 9 to 11 or 9 to 1, right? I get tired then. Imagine if you're like a professional DJ or like a touring DJ and you play somewhere for 4 hours, then you have a 2-hour break and play somewhere else again for another 4 hours and another 2-hour set to end it at the end of the night. Like, that kind of schedule, I'm not sure if you've ever DJed before, the mental exhaustion, having to stand up the whole time, moving around in clubs, which is not the easiest place to move around, even if you're going behind the backstage doors and stuff, whatever, it's incredibly tiring, really, really is tiring. So I don't think there's any way that you could do it, especially in the beginning, right, without abusing some sort of substances, without going through the whole class A drug kind of journey, right? And then maybe towards the end of it, especially even with alcohol, maybe towards the end of it, you will reach a point where you start to become cognitive of how you get when you start to drink and how it affects the ability to DJ, and you might start tampering it. Me being a good example, I used to get on it or drink whilst I was DJing, right? But now, since like probably the beginning of the year, since I've been coming, like been doing it more professionally, I've been doing it more often every single month, and because I'm being counted, I'm relied on, and I've got this pressure, I've kind of got my inbuilt pressure to kind of make sure that I impress so people can call me back. I will maybe only have a drink 2 hours into my set, which is really rare for me. If you know how I am and how I go out and how I do things, how I go out there, you'll know that, you know, having a drink 2 hours into my set is very, like, out of character. Usually I'll have, like, loads of pre-drinks at home, especially if I'm going on a night out. That's kind of what I do. Back in the day, I just, like, copy that lifestyle and just integrate into my DJing. But then I realized that it would only fuck up my DJing and it would only make me more cognitive to the time, which is weird, right? You wouldn't think that, but I noticed whenever I got on it whilst I was DJing, I was more aware of what the time was. I knew how long things were taking. I was like dreading the next hour and a half, or I was like, oh my God, I don't have enough tunes. Oh my God, I think I'm gonna fuck up. You know what I mean? Just like those little mental games you play with yourself. But when I'm not drinking, or when I'm just kind of really in the zone and I'm really kind of in pocket and I'm just kind of concentrating on what I'm doing, right? The time doesn't go anywhere. I mean, the time kind of stands still, but also moves quickly. It's a weird, it kind of like works in the same way. You know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of when I took acid when I went to Primavera this year, right? I remember lying down on my bed and I took acid, right, for the first time. And I remember looking over to the table because I had like a glass of whiskey with some, a glass of whiskey and Coke on the table. No, just a glass of whiskey with a couple of ice cubes, right? Some big ice cubes. And what I remember seeing was the ice melting really quickly, but then the water going, rising up really fast. So the ice melting really slowly, but the water rising up really fast, like in unison. So it go, it was so freaky. And then my senses of my ears would just kind of get really sensitive, and I could hear birds that were like miles and miles away. It sounded like they were fucking in, like literally in my ears. It was fucking so insane, so amazing, but it kind of freaked me out a little bit. And I wasn't the best acid participant because I was really resisting it. I was really like kind of holding on and not wanting to let go. Kind of like when I took my first time when I took MDMA, I was like just holding on, like, no, must not swing my jaw. I mean, and you shouldn't do that. It's just like, you know, let it go. But yeah, there is a kind of, you have to go through it, right? So I kind of have sympathy for Jackmaster for going through it. And looking at his tour schedule now on Resident Advisor, right? Up and coming events that he's doing. This is an insane schedule already. Just look at the locations, right? He's playing at Sonus Festival, right? This Sunday in Croatia. Then from there, he goes next Sunday to Sweden. I'm sure, does he live in Glasgow still? Or does he live in London? I'm not too sure if he lives. So that might mean he might go back to Glasgow. So from Croatia, he might go back to Glasgow during the week, then fly back out to Sweden, right? On a Sunday. And then the week after that, fly back out to Ibiza. And then from Ibiza, he might go, because there's a break between the 20th and the 15th. He might then go back home and then fly to Tokyo on the 15th of September. And then after that, from Tokyo, he goes to Bali on the same day, right? Then he comes, then from Bali, he flies back to the UK. So that's a 14-hour flight, right? So let's not, 14, 13-hour flight. Then from the UK, so he comes back to the Fly Open Air Festival in the UK on the 22nd of September. Then from there, he goes and flies to Manchester. So it's Edinburgh, Manchester on the 28th. Then on the 29th, he goes to Bristol. Then on the 27th of August, he's at Glasgow. And these are all the dates that have been confirmed. The stuff in between hasn't been confirmed yet. It's like, oh my fucking God, right? That event list is amazing. And if you check, let's check the past ones that come up, right? So it's, how could you not do drugs? How could you not get fucked up on substances? It's impossible. Look at that schedule from July. I'm just going to say from July, right? So this is what he's doing from July. This is absolutely insane, man. I didn't even know that the schedule. So in July, on the 1st of July, he played at Electric Island in Canada, in Toronto. Then he flew to Turin in Italy on a Saturday to play for Saturday, the 7th of July, and the Sunday, the 8th of July. So at the weekend, on Saturday and Sunday in Turin. Then from there, from the 13th, he flew back to London and played at the Revolution Day, Stop Trump, Stop Brexit party and protest. That didn't work, did it, brothers? Then he played at Love Box on the same day. Then from there, he flew to Canary Islands and played at Greenwood Camouflage. Then he played at Samian Dance with Seth Troxler at Paris on the 14th. Then Circo Loco on the 16th. Then on the 28th, he played in Portugal. 28th in Portugal again. Circo Loco in Ibiza. Never World again back in London. Love Fest. Jesus Christ. It's insane, man. That schedule's insane. So, yes, it was a funny story. You shit into a kettle, but I would shit into a kettle too if I was playing those kind of tour dates. It's just impossible to do it sober. It's impossible. Literally impossible. Especially in the beginning. Now, when he's kind of coming up to his pump. Maybe he'll get to a point like Seth Troxler did, right? Where he kind of, I think he even says like his engagement kind of broke down because of his touring and not being around. And, you know, maybe substance abuse played into it as well. Maybe, you know, he had a bit of a wandering eye. We don't know what the story was, but he's now kind of like sober for the most part and only smokes weed. So maybe he might get to that point too, but I don't know. I have a bit of sympathy towards it. And also the weird thing is, well, you know what? If this story is true, this is as to his legend. It adds to the legend of Jackmaster. Like, people would want to book him even more now. You know what I mean? He probably might start DJing behind a booth and just pull out a kettle. You know, like that DJ. Who's that DJ that pulls out a plant? Like, hey, everyone, big up this plant, man. Big up whoever gave me this plant. There's some DJ that did that kind of thing. Imagine if he just comes up behind a DJ booth and has a kettle behind him and pours himself a cup of tea. That would be fucking amazing. Big up Jackmaster. I still love you, brother. And I can feel your pain.